We're in the Atlas control room with Chris Morris, who I've grown up seeing on TV and radio and being scared of at some level. But he's not in Paxman mode today, yet.
How many particles is it, different kinds of particles, is it designed to detect?
So, well, there are quite a lot, actually, because it's not fundamental particles, it's things like protons and neutrons and pions and electrons and photons. So, you know, I suppose you could say 10 or 20 different kinds of particles you might see, probably more actually. And you can identify them. One way is because we have a very strong magnetic field in there, and so that bends anything with electric charge. And so because you know how much the field is, and you measure how much it bends, you can work out how fast it's going. So it's momentum. So it's kind of a, you build up a picture with lots of different measurements of the
explosion. What is then a fundamental particle?
At the moment, we
definition of a fundamental particle.
Something that we can see has no internal structure at the moment. So at the moment we know of 12 of them. So there are the six quarks, the three leptons, like the electron, the muon and the tau, and then three neutrinos. And as far as we can tell, they're fundamental. They might not be. I mean, it may be that there's substructure to those things. And that's one thing that Atlas may find. It's unlikely, actually.
So is there substructure to a photon?
No, a photon's a fundamental particle. Although, yeah. So I didn't mention the force carriers. So there are 12 fundamental matter particles that we know of, and then four force-carrying particles, the photon, gluon, which carries the strong force, and the W and Z, which carry the weak force. So
where does the Higgs then fit in? Is that related to this as well? So this will detect the event, will it?
Yeah, the Higgs is the missing link in that picture of the world called the Standard Model. So included in that, the equations that describe the 12 matter particles and the three of the four forces, gravity's out on a limb, included in that is the Higgs. And the Higgs gives mass to the W and the Z and the quarks and the electron. And that's a theoretical construct, though, and we haven't found it yet. So if that exists, then Atlas will see it.
Is the idea basically that in some sort of selective way, a Higgs boson gives mass on some but not all particles, which have in common the fact that they don't have mass?
Exactly. So the photon doesn't talk to the Higgs at all. The picture is there's a field, the Higgs field, which permeates all space, and particles that have mass because they interact with the Higgs field. So it's like treacle, and they interact with the treacle and you know, in a sense, slow down. They get mass, whereas the photon and the gluon, which is also massless, just don't talk to it, so they get no mass. So in a fundamental way, everything's... At the start of the universe, the picture is that everything was massless, and then the Higgs field appears at some point.
It's a very pleasing idea, isn't it? Because it feels simple at the level that we're talking about it. I'm sure it isn't. But that nothing has mass, but they move through a field which gives some of them the appearance of having... Is it the appearance of having mass or actually mass?
It's in the sense that you have mass. So, you know, you really do. I mean, your particles don't travel around at the speed of light. You know,
does a Higgs boson have mass?
Yeah, yeah. And it gives itself mass.
It gives itself mass.
So there's a so-called self-interaction. It's actually the general rule. Photons don't talk to each other, right? So photons just, and you can tell that because you can see the other side of the room, and the photons that are flying around don't bang into them. That's actually unusual. So gluons, which are the carriers of the strong nuclear force, they do talk to each other, and they bounce into each other. W and Z particles talk to each other. So photons actually are the kind of exception in a way.
I mean, I read somewhere that it's you strongly expect to find it, the Higgs boson.
Well, the correct way to say it is whatever generates mass in the universe, we'll see that mechanism. Because we know where that mechanism happens, we know at what energy it happens, and we've deliberately built the LHC beyond that energy. So you have to see whatever it is. Now, the Higgs is a bit predictive, quite predictive actually. So we've had the Higgs in the Standard Model, and you can calculate things, and there are kind of hints of it that you can see that we've seen already, in a sense that it all works. So the theory with the Higgs works. Take it away, by the way, and it doesn't work at all. So you have to have something in there to generate mass. And the Higgs is a simple, as you said, it's quite a simple and elegant guess. But it's a guess, it's a theoretical guess. So you might not see it, but then you'll see something else. One way of thinking about it is if you're massless in this universe, you travel at the speed of light. So it's, everything that's massless travels at the speed of light. So the speed of light in itself actually is a bit of a misnomer. It's the speed of massless objects. And the photon happens to be massless, and therefore it goes at that speed. And we call it the speed of light because that's the first thing we thought of that went, or the first thing we discovered. But anything that, if you don't have mass, you go at the speed of light. If you have mass, you can stop. So you can sit still. So it's kind of a fundamental property in that sense.
So you can't stop a photon?
No, it goes at the speed of light.
So that thing about a torch, if you were theoretically travelling at the speed of light and you switched on a torch...
Well, I'll tell you what's really interesting, actually, because the whole thing is difficult to think of, because for a photon, no time passes at all, right? So time stops for light. So if you go at the speed of light, no time passes. So you can't go at the speed of light and then switch on your torch, actually. It's one way of thinking about it, right? Because no time passes at all.
Okay,
so
if you're just less than the speed of light and you switch on the torch, does the photon sort of trickle out?
No, it goes at the speed of light. If you're travelling at 99.99999% of the speed of light, which is actually the speed that the protons are travelling at in the LHC, and you were to turn a torch on, the light beam would disappear away from you at the speed of light. So that's one of the very strange and basic things about relativity.
But to somebody observing that, would that light be moving faster than the speed of light?
It would be moving at the speed of light. Velocity addition doesn't work in relativity.
Okay.
Right? So nothing travels faster than the speed of light. It's the universal speed limit.
Okay.
So you fly towards me at 99% speed of light with a torch and turn it on, and the light will recede from you at the speed of light, and it will hit me at the speed of light. But what changes is the colour of the light. So that's where you hear redshift and blue shift. So what I'd see if you were coming flying towards me really quickly is I'd see, if you had a red torch, it'd be blue when it got to me. Yeah, because that's what happened instead of the speed. So something's got to happen. Yeah. So actually the frequency goes up, so the colour changes. The thing about Atlas and CMS are that they're just general purpose cameras, right? So in a real way, you're just taking pictures and looking for anything that you don't understand. And it may just be something you haven't thought of. You might think, well, that's ridiculous. I just saw three muons come flying out of there and nothing else. What the hell's that? No one ever thought of that. You know, so you've got to be ready. And the real trick is that we can't record all the collisions by any means. So, you know, we can get up to 600 million collisions a second. Right, at the LHC. And we can record about 200 a second onto disk, because it's like a 100 megapixel camera. It's got about 100 million readout channels. So imagine getting a 100 megapixel camera and taking a picture 600 million times a second. It's not, there aren't enough disks in the universe to record that. So we can do about 200. So we've got to throw away the overwhelming majority of collisions. And so we have to have some way of doing that very fast. It's what Torsten works on, actually. You could talk about that. So we have these really fast computers that you'll see. And all they're supposed to do is look really very quickly at a collision and say, it's not interesting. Nothing interesting happened. Because usually nothing interesting happens. But you can't throw away the interesting stuff, even though you don't know what it is. So it's that's a tricky thing. And even 200 a second is a huge amount of data.
Is there a possibility that the stuff that is destined to be thrown away could, in 50 years' time, be deemed to be the essential information?
Yes. Torsten, so we're talking about the trigger, which is your job. Chris just asked whether
we'll put a figure on it then, because Brian just said that there's a chance that you could be throwing away all the essential data.
Yeah,
because hanging on to.
I mean, as opposed to the previous one, right? Now we really cannot take all the events that we're interested in. We really have to make a selection at the beginning. So to put a number on it, we have to throw away 99.9995% of all the collisions we have to throw away. So what we can save in the end is 200 per second. What we get in is 40 million per second times 25 collisions per. So it's like a billion. So what do we do? So we basically have to make up our minds what we want to look for. And it's pretty much a simple strategy because we're building a high-energy machine. So we look at high-energy things.
So in the assessment, how many criteria, roughly, are you applying to an event in order to decide whether to chuck it?
It increases with each stage. So in the beginning, it could be something like, say, on the order of less than 10 criteria, if you wish. in a very simple case.
Things like, has it got two muons in it? If there are two muons, you go, that's usually interesting, we'll have that. You know, has it got missing energy? It's got missing energy, take it. It's just really simple things like that.
And then you go up all the way to, you know, did I have a track that went through all of my subdetectors? And can I do a track fit, which tells me that actually the line that I tried to put through it is close enough to all the hits to make it plausible and so on. So in the very end, we really can run something quite sophisticated.
But is there any... Okay, is this a valid parallel? Am I right in thinking, there's two questions coming at once now, but that Einstein slagged himself off for his constant, and that later the constant was found to relate to things more complex than he'd imagined.
Yes.
Is there a possibility that the decision to throw material away may turn out to be the very thing? The thing that you, in a way, are slagging yourself off for might maybe the very thing you needed.
Yes.
And what's the and have you calculated the chance of that?
We do take random events. So we take a number of events that would not have passed any criteria at all. So we can look at those, and we will, and we'll make sure that nothing interesting is happening in the random ones. So that's one way you can do it.
You can never completely exclude that you'll miss something. Right?
No, of course.
But in a way, the last people we trust is ourselves. So I mean, we always sit there and we think, you know, we do this and it sounds like a really clever idea. Let's just assume this is a really stupid idea. And what do we do to find out? So it's basically, for example, we will have triggers which. Which will, in principle, give us a very high rate, so we cannot actually save all the events. So we just randomly select every 1,000th. And then there will be people looking and say, look, if I had taken all of them, yeah, would I have seen something? Yeah. It's not perfect. You can never replace saving everything, but there's a lot of checks in there.
Can you reuse the machine, if it is technically correct to call it a machine?
It's an interesting question, because the one that was here before, called LEP, which is the Electron-Positron Collider, there was a plan to be able to put that back in again, and actually in the tunnel, in the LHC tunnel, there's room to put that back in again, because we might have wanted to collide electrons with protons, because that's interesting, that's what we did. My PhD was on that in Hamburg. It turns out that you wouldn't do that, so we're not going to do it now with that machine, because it's just too expensive and you just build another one actually. But there's always an idea that you might reuse the bits. In fact, one of the magnets of one of the experiments that was here at LEP in the 90s has been taken to Japan and is being used in a thing called T2K, which is an experiment to shoot a beam of neutrinos through the ground from one end of Japan to the other and detect them in this thing called Kamiokande. And we're reusing one of the magnets from here. We shipped it to Japan. So we do that. We recycle, very green. and it's of course carbon neutral, because it's France and that's nuclear powered, so 80% of the energy is nuclear, so it's all very good. So you could well see the tunnel being reused possibly at some point, but it would be just a more powerful machine in the same tunnel. But digging the tunnel is the most expensive bit.
So technologically, like sort of everything else, you could imagine in 100 years time a particle collider that can do this.
Of your hands.
Yeah.
That's what people are watching.
Well, it would make the health and safety aspect more exciting, because presumably by that stage you could be, because a miniature black hole, in the barroom conversation version of this, the mention of a black hole being generated here, even a small one, doesn't get much examination apart from people sort of go, well, that, I'm not having that. Or, but then you, would it be, if this, and I know this, okay, without fear of incriminating yourself in any way, but would it be instant if one did? Because I mean, you once told me that this might destroy the universe, right?
No,
but
I would, never said that. I wouldn't say that.
Didn't you have to write this down?
I'm sure you did. Maybe you sang it. Okay.
I'm anyway. Just trying to scare you while you were cooking.
I think it was just,
just put a bit more chili in it.
But no, would if you create a catastrophic event, is it going to be instant, or no? Not in. Okay, I'm just talking theory now. Would it be slow?
We could create. Unlikely, but we could create little black holes. So it's not a question of if you create a black hole, then we've all had it, because we could create little black holes. Yeah. Two things to say. One is that if we can do it, then nature's already doing it in the upper atmosphere, because cosmic rays are hitting the Earth with energies far in excess of these all the time. So if something nasty happens, then it's happening now above your head, and the Earth's still here, so it's fine. So we know that. The theory is that if you can make a little black hole, it will be far smaller than a proton, by the way, far, far smaller, then it will evaporate away very quickly, and the trick is to see them. So, one of the challenges at Atlas is to be ready to see these little black holes evaporating away, and it's difficult to see, actually. So it's not like it's obvious because Atlas disappears and you go, hey, we made one. It's completely the opposite. The second thing is they're so small that even if they didn't evaporate, nothing comes close enough to them. Matter is basically empty space. So even if it doesn't evaporate, which is unthinkable, actually, knowing the laws of physics that we know, they're so tiny that nothing ever gets to fall into it, so it never gets any bigger. So it probably just, even for some reason it didn't evaporate, it just sit there. So you wouldn't see it then, so we wouldn't know we'd made one.
Right. I think for the barroom conversation, I mean, physicists never trust a theorist to tell them what's going to happen, right? So, I mean, the real answer is it's been happening. The cosmic rays. So no reason to cancel your mortgage yet.
Well, there's many reasons to cancel your mortgage. Yeah, right. Yeah. This isn't one of them.
I'm here for financial advice, maybe.
We've come to CMS, which is a first for the podcast. We never come to CMS. It's the other experiment, not mine. But my friend Albert de Rook has agreed to take us around.
CMS stands for the Compact Muon Solenoid. And there are three words in that: compact, and that what you will see before. It's indeed smaller in size, but in fact twice as heavy as Atlas. So in that sense, everything is squeezed together. In fact, the saying went around in CMS that in if you forgot in 94 to foresee a cable which has to run somewhere from your detector to the outside, there would simply be no place anymore to do it afterwards. So you could forget about the cable. And muons, because the main emphasis around which the principle of this CMS experiment is built is around detecting high energy muons, which are usually messengers for new physics and very clean messengers for that. So that was determined the design of the experiment. And solenoid, because we wanted to stay with like a classical type of experiment, unlike Atlas, which has gone for a different magnetical structure. We used just one magnet, a solenoid, a big solenoid, but a solenoid of a type that had never been built before. Strong, 4 Tesla field, which is enormously strong for such a big magnet, and 6 meter diameter type of magnet. And so they had to really to make the whole design of the magnet and the whole, you know, that was an experiment by itself. And like 2 years ago, this magnet was complete. It's a big superconducting magnet, and tried, and it actually worked, which was a big sigh of relief for the whole collaboration, because the experiment would stand or fall with the working of that magnet. The gray structure under the red structure there, this is this enormous magnet. One of my collaborators made once a joke to his, or at least he tried to explain to his family what he was doing and what really the magnitude of this whole thing was. And that you say, well, this magnet is so powerful and is so big that you could use it as a scanner, a medical scanner for whales. It only worked half the way he explained, because his mother now thinks he's a marine biologist. And his sister's now wondering why there are whales in Geneva. She never heard about that.
Seems to me that it's doing the same, very much the same kind of thing to the one at Atlas. So how does it differ in that it's bending particles and it's catching them in these detectors?
Atlas has also a solenoid, apart from other magnets which are on the other side. The solenoid is smaller, I think as half the size in the diameter about, and half the field. So it was not such a technological challenge as this would be. It was more like a magnet like we knew how to construct them before. Now the difference with Atlas and with CMS in that respect is these detectors are like onions. They have different shells at different layers. There's a layer following another layer of different type of detectors. The inner layer is what we call a layer which sees the charged particles going. It really sees the trajectories. Like in the old Babbage chambers, you could see a trajectory, but this time electronically. And then straight around that, you have the Atlas magnet. Now, a magnet is very good for analyzing and seeing curvature, but it disturbs the particles. If a particle goes through the magnet, it can get scattered, it can start interacting with the magnet, and you lose it for further analysis. So the philosophy here is putting more detectors inside the magnet and thus making the magnet bigger to have the particles undisturbed going to the next layers of detectors. And there are two next layers, and these are calorimeters. These are things, detectors, which measure directly the energy of a particle or of a jet of particles. And we wanted to have that, to measure that as precise as possible, and therefore have the magnet not disturb them, and therefore have a big magnet. Also, since we have a smaller size version of experiment, our magnet needed to be stronger. There's a lot of iron in this. This red stuff is iron. It doesn't look much. All the red stuff you see is iron. It doesn't look much at first, but in this experiment, there is more iron than in the Eiffel Tower.
Where did it come from?
That's another interesting story. They come from Russia. And it comes from decommissioned shells for battleships, you know, when they fire at each other. And they decommissioned them. And there was a huge pile of shell metal they had around, and they melted that again and made it in structure like this. So this one of our disarmament peaceful treaties has led to the fact that we could add good and cheap metal from the Russian Navy.
So what year did they offer up these shells?
That must have been middle of the 90s.
They might want them back now.
Well, no way they're going to get them.
Iron can move a lot as well, can't it? Iron is heat sensitive, so in terms of the precision of this instrument, presumably there's quite a lot that needs to go into controlling the plasticity of iron.
That's right. One of the major challenges of an experiment like this is that, you know, it's so gigantic and massive and inert it looks, but you need to treat it like a tabletop experiment in terms of precision. So you need to go to 100 micron, sometimes 10 micrometer type of precision of the detectors, knowing where they are relative in space and controlling where they are with time. And there are very sophisticated methods developed to actually do that, usually based on laser systems where we shoot laser beams through and measure displacements which can happen. And we have to monitor that, and it is indeed true that these kind of things, we try to stabilize as much as possible here, but there will be some temperature variations. We have to take that into account, and we have to feed that into our software, which is going to be used for reconstructing the trajectories of particles moving to this detector.
And does this have the same sort of filtering process as over at Atlas to eliminate irrelevant information?
Pretty much the same. I mean, probably Brian told you that we have something like a 40 megahertz type of clocking that something can happen in this in the collisions. And when the beam intensity gets up to good level, indeed, 40 million times per second, an interaction will happen in the middle of that detector. Most of those are of lesser interest for us than others. It's always good to have a sample of something. But most of them we will be not so interested. So we have basically the same type of what is called trigger philosophy, so that we select online with the first glimpses of data which we have within a couple of microseconds whether we would like to keep that event for further or not. And from the 40 million, we have to go to like 1 to 200, which is about the filter. Part is done with what is called the level one trigger, where you decide fast. And another part is done with software on a filter farm, which will contain about 1,000 processors, which will be working in parallel, each one on different events, trying to crunch and decide, according to filters which we program, whether or not this is an event which could be of interest and, for example, contain signatures for new physics. The other, the 99.9 or more percent, which we don't take, is lost forever. We had it in our hands once, but we decided, no, let it go, it's gone. There's no way of ever getting that back.
Is the limiting factor the conducting rate of wire, or is it the speed of the computer?
It's more like a sensible type of limit. I mean, if now already with writing like 100 to 200 events per second, you produce petabytes of data per year. And that's getting close to the amount you can really analyze sensibly in a good way with calibration, with reprocessing and things like that. Maybe a factor of 10 would have been still possible now with it, but it gets close to that. But storage-wise, data handle it wise? I mean, we will produce the same amount of data as you have in the whole Britannica, Encyclopedia Britannica, per second. Each second, we produce that volume of data. Now, there are 10 to the 7 seconds per year, so that's the amount of Encyclopedia Britannicas we're going to have with the rate as it is now. And that was one of the delimiting factors. But it's also a matter of money. If we would put faster processes, faster this, faster that, then probably we could handle more. But we would never want to handle something like 40 million events per second, because that would create a data volume which would swamp us completely, and the whole computing grid system within a day. So.
But in 10 years' time, it might be possible to handle that amount of data.
Sure. And we are also thinking in what we're going to do with these detectors in 10 years' time. And there are plans for looking for upgrades, and that's one of the things to look at, what we do in case of upgrades. But it should be said, this factor of million and so sounds big, but most of the events are very easy to kill because they are clear. They don't have anything interesting. They have only soft type of particles, and we don't believe that new physics will manifest itself in there. So it's for the time being, it's okay, we can handle it. It's also said that if we run for 10 years, the amount of data that goes to our data acquisition, which is not necessarily written out, but that goes through our data acquisition over a period of 10 years, is more than the words spoken by man since they appeared on Earth.
Chris, I'd like to know what your impression is now after seeing Atlas and CMS.
Well, I think I've just said it, that my last thought is that we haven't started. Because it feels like there's at least, well, no, not an infinite number of questions, but it just opens up a massive number of questions, and your circuitry is completely overloaded, not just by the concepts, but also the scale of the place and the seemingly infinite measure of what is required to keep it going, let alone, in fact, you lose sight of the actual experiment very quickly when you visit it here. So I don't, there's no conclusive thought apart from the fact that it's fascinating.